It's time for Mid-South Viewpoint. Hi, I'm Byron Tyler. Glad you could join us on this edition of our program. The Mid-South Viewpoint broadcast typically brings you local programming of interest, such as ministries in the inner city, things that are impacting our community. Well, there's things happening in our community that are impacting other parts of the world. You probably have seen in the news about the Ebola epidemic that's affecting West Africa in some very tragic numbers. People's lives are as we speak right now, it's growing and growing, this epidemic. One particular country is mentioned, Sierra Leone, and you possibly have heard us in the past on Mid-South Viewpoint interview some ladies from Women of Hope International, a ministry that was founded and directed by Kim Carbo. Kim actually was raised in Sierra Leone by missionary parents, studied to become a nurse, went back to Sierra Leone to do ministry, and that was really the birth and vision that started what we see today as Women of Hope International. There's a whole lot more elements to it, but today we felt it was a necessity to get together and tell you, our Bot Radio Network listeners, about how you can engage this very moment in this Ebola epidemic in West Africa. Kim, good to see you. How are you doing?
Thank you, Byron. It's good to see you too.
I mean, you have been, I know, mobilizing and doing a lot lately since the outbreak has been announced.
We have, yes. Because Sierra Leone is where we work primarily, as soon as this outbreak reached Sierra Leone, which was several months ago, and it had maintained itself sort of in one corner of the country, but it has very slowly and insidiously spread itself across the country. And just last week was when it actually reached the area that we work in Sierra Leone. So that sort of upped the ante for us in terms of refocusing some efforts on Ebola prevention.
The epidemic itself, for those who might not, you know, understand what it's about, its impact on our bodies. When did we first, you know, hear about Ebola? Can you talk about that?
Sure. Ebola is it's a hemorrhagic fever disease, and it's a virus. There is no cure for Ebola. There's also, but there are a lot of ways to prevent it. It is not easily caught, and so it's really not as horrifying as people try to make it. It's sort of not quite the outbreak movie, you know, scenario. In real life. But because of a lot of factors that have to do with infrastructure in West Africa and people's educational level on disease transmission and germ theory, that has sort of changed the paradigm of how Ebola has taken place in West Africa, even as opposed to some of the other outbreaks in Central Africa in the past. And really, Ebola starts out like any other fever disease, and that's why it's a little bit difficult to catch it early on, because there's so many fever diseases in Africa, malaria, typhoid, and Ebola looks a lot like those right on the onset. And so those are things that are so common to people. It's like getting a cold, you know. So when people get malaria in Africa, it's not a big deal. It's sort of, everybody expects to have malaria at several points in time in their life. And so they don't see it as a really serious situation to have a fever. And usually people will just stay at home and try to take care of themselves and take malaria treatment and that sort of thing. This has sort of changed the paradigm in Sierra Leone. So now everything that starts with a fever is sort of looked at as with suspicion. But the initial onset is just a sudden fever, severe weakness, fatigue, and then it'll lead to like sore throat. There'll be the initial symptoms also, sore throat, stomach ache, and then it'll lead to vomiting and diarrhea and then bleeding from the orphan. That's like long into the process. And that's not all cases either. That's just sort of the most severe, where there's bleeding from different body parts.
Okay, so you said there's no cure, but it is treatable.
There's no cure. It is supportive treatment is all that there's available. So people that get in early for treatment and can stay rehydrated, that's a big problem because there is the diarrhea and vomiting. So people become dehydrated very quickly. If they can maintain good nutrition, keep their immune system boosted, and provide a lot of supportive care to the patient, including rehydration and fluids and things like that, in the midst of fighting this, the body can fight it off. So we've seen a difference in this outbreak than the ones previous. Previously, Ebola had a 90% fatality rate. This current outbreak, Ebola has a 55% fatality rate. So that's completely different than it had been. That's a whole lot better. Half and half is a whole lot better than almost for sure, you know, to be dead. So this is a little bit different scenario, and that has helped a lot. But so there's no cure, but there is supportive treatment that if people get in early, they can have a good chance of survival. And it really does depend on early treatment.
I think it's important, too, that we discuss a little about Women of Hope International so that those listening will understand why you have such a heart, of course, for Sierra Leone. As I mentioned in the beginning, you grew up in Sierra Leone with missionary family. And of course, you have spent a lot of time there doing ministry. Mm-hmm. But the specific ministry that Women of Hope International does, and I think is just a wonderful display of God's grace, His mercy, and His providence, and that is working with women with disabilities.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, our primary ministry is to women affected by disability, and so that includes women who have a disability, but also women whose children have a disability. And that's really our primary focus. So it's not a huge population, but it is significant in the world. 10% of people in the world, between 10 and 15, depending on the stats that you look at, have a disability. So that's a large number of people in any population group. In Sierra Leone, the stigmas and ostracism associated with disability are quite severe. And so our women that we work with tend to be the poorest. They tend to be people who don't have any kind of income. They normally have not gone to school. So they have a lot of risk factors just in general for their health status. But then when Ebola comes into play as well, it is going to be sort of the poor and the most vulnerable that are most susceptible to getting this virus because they don't have a lot of education about how to prevent disease transmission. And they also don't have necessarily good nutritional status. So their body's immune systems are not as strong as maybe some other people who have a little more advantage. So our women are probably a little more at risk in situations like this. People with disability would be at risk significantly more than the average person. And so plus once a crisis like this hits a country, everyone's focus becomes about that crisis. And so for our staff, everything they're doing right now, though we're still working with the same target population, everything that they're doing right now is sort of focused on Ebola education and Ebola prevention. The Ebola virus has only just hit our region of the country, so we're on the front end of that and can probably have a significant impact in prevention as opposed to treatment. We're not a treatment facility. We don't operate clinics or anything like that. The other thing is that our primary focus with our women is a lot of community health education. We define health much more broadly than just sort of physical disease prevention. But
basic hygiene we're talking about.
There's that. But we look at health in a broader context, you know, the emotional, the spiritual, the physical, all of that put together. And so that's really our focus all the time is community health. And we do a lot of education and training with our women. We sort of specialize in providing community health education to people who have very low literacy levels. So there's a different approach to teaching someone who has no education, period, who hasn't even been exposed to education. Because, for example, in our context, we use a lot of symbols, and we all understand what those symbols mean. So whether you've been to school or you don't, they're all over our community, where they're throughout society. But people that have very low educational levels and very low literacy levels in countries that's sort of the norm, don't have symbol recognition either. And they don't also have visual recognition. So it's interesting as we do education with women who have zero literacy level that you can present a picture to them and the picture itself doesn't make sense. So it might be a perfectly clear picture to us, but or a symbol that means something to most people. But to them, it doesn't have meaning because there's not books everywhere. There's not signs everywhere. So there's not a lot of visual literacy in their community. And so that makes it a little trickier to try to provide community health education to people who have very low literacy levels. And that's kind of our specialty. So that's where we've kind of jumped in. And actually, the global community health networks have started to tap us for educational materials that would be suitable to sort of the village level learner to try to help prevent this Ebola outbreak.
So the biggest challenge in addressing the concerns of Ebola would be?
Biggest challenge is helping people understand that they can prevent it, that it's not the monster in the closet. You know, that that if you turn the light on that monster in the closet, you can really alleviate a lot of those fears. So trying to prevent the fear that's driving some of the behaviors. Also then trying to help them understand what the disease transmission process is. But then also really, to be honest, Byron, Ebola in Sierra Leone and throughout West Africa where it's affecting people right now, Ebola is really a symptom of a much bigger problem. And that really is that the fear issues, the animistic worldview issues, and the lack of education are contributing to the fact that this Ebola outbreak is much different than the Ebola outbreaks of the past. And so this is really, this is sort of bringing to light a bigger problem that people need just basic education about how our bodies work, about how disease transmission work, about germ theory, just some real basic things that really we learn sort of from little up. You know, when we are little and we have a cold, you know, you cough or sneeze, you're told to cover your mouth. You cough into your hand, you're told to go wash your hands with soap. You know, we teach our kids that right from little up. But in Sierra Leone and places like Sierra Leone, that's not the norm. And so there's not a lot of sort of general education or general knowledge about just general disease transmission processes. And that is increasing the spread. One of the examples that would illustrate this is in Sierra Leone and places like that, where if you would go to a public building, there's not drinking fountains, but if you were thirsty, there might be a bucket of water with a lid on it and a cup sitting on top of the lid. Everybody that comes into that building would go and, if they wanted a drink, lift the lid, dip the cup into the water, take a drink, put the lid back on and set the cup back on top. Everyone's going to keep doing that. So the same cup's being dipped into the water, the same cup's being used by all the people around. We wouldn't do that in our cultural context. We would be afraid of disease, particularly with strangers. We might in our family. If I'm, you know, you and I are family and we know that we're not sick, we would not do that. We would share. But we would stop doing that if we knew that one of us was sick, because we don't want to share. So, but in Sierra Leone, they don't understand that disease process. And so they just go ahead and share cups, share spoons, share plates. Sick people eat on the same plates as well people. And so there's a lot of just simple things like that that are not understood to be potentially disease transmitting behaviors. And that has contributed to some of these types of things. There's also issues like in this particular issue with Ebola, one of their practices is when somebody dies, the family all gathers around. There's a lot of, it's very demonstrative culture. So there's a lot of wailing. There's a lot of, you know, people are very demonstrative. So in their crying, they'll throw themselves down on the ground. They'll throw themselves on the body. And that's expected, and it demonstrates that you're truly grieving. But if you throw yourself on the body of a person with Ebola, the viral levels in the body fluids of an Ebola patient increase from the time of first onset of symptoms to the time of death. So a person who has just died of Ebola has huge viral levels in their body fluids. So there's much more possibility of transmission from a person that just died of Ebola than somebody who just started having symptoms. And so the farther they go through the disease process, the more, the higher the volume of virus in the body fluids. So that is a very dangerous thing in the Ebola outbreak. And so trying to get people to understand not to touch bodies of dead people because who potentially died of Ebola has also been a cause of the spread of the disease. And so there's just some common cultural practices like that that stem from maybe a lack of information about disease processes and transmission that have increased the level of spread of this particular outbreak.
Are the people receptive to the education? As you mentioned, you're dealing with, you know, years and years of culture and practice that they didn't even think about. So, I mean, are they receptive to the education and willing to change those practices?
By and large, no. It's difficult to change a cultural practice. But then also there's also the idea of without understanding the rationale behind a practice, practices can be taken to extreme. And so you get a sort of all or nothing type of mentality. So right now, one of the things that people are grieving in West Africa is that in a culture that's very touchy-feely, I mean, they have no personal space issues. They don't have bubbles like we do. People are afraid of each other. They won't shake hands. There's no more hugging. And, you know, so people's practices of greeting and associating with each other have been altered. some of that is so extreme, it's not necessary. But because of the fear, it's caused sort of an extreme reaction, the pendulum swing effect. And so that has made a difference. But the other thing is that people don't, there's a lot of conspiracy and fear and rumor that's surrounding this whole Ebola virus. And people don't believe that it's a real medical disease. They believe that there is a conspiracy that either foreigners have brought something to Sierra Leone or to West Africa to try to either make a profit. There is one rumor that says that if you go into those treatment centers that they will say you have Ebola, but it's not really true. Really what they're trying to do is get people into these containment centers and then they harvest their organs and sell them on the black market. So that's one fear. The other fear is that it's not really an actual disease, but that once you get sick with a fever, a common whatever, could be malaria, and you go into these treatment centers, they inject you with a fatal injection. Right. And so those are some of the fears that we're trying to counter through the education that we're providing, because those have to be addressed. You can't just give people facts.
Right. Well, is harvesting organs one of the issues that they're actually seeing happen in their country?
No. Well, in the past, I mean, there's rumors of that happening. And there are, you know, with the whole trafficking incidents and things like that, there's a lot of heightened awareness of the dangers of, you know, I don't know, bad people. Whereas, you know, maybe people didn't really think about those things before, but, and it really only takes, one person who's a suspicious or paranoid who then sort of starts a theory like this and it just spreads like wildfire.
Yeah.
And so that, you know, and especially in a crisis where there's already a lot of fear, and people are looking for answers. And so, you know, as somebody comes up with an answer, another example very recently, because of some of these animistic beliefs and just, the worldview issues that surround this, just this past Friday night, a phone text message went viral throughout West Africa. It started in Nigeria by a so-called prophet. This prophet took a passage from 2 Kings and extrapolated it and started spreading a message that the cure to this virus and the way to stop the outbreak was that everyone needed to get up, boil water, mix a salt solution and wash their body with water. And in Nigeria, it was also drink the salt water. This went viral on Friday night. Our staff contacted us and this was a situation that sort of epitomizes how people are reacting to some of these things. And this literally, about 90% of the population of Sierra Leone did this that night. 3 o'clock in the morning, people were at boiling water. I mean, that requires starting a fire, gathering firewood. You know, we're talking about a significant task. Boiling water, getting the salt solution mixed, and washing everybody in the house with salt water, and this was supposed to stop the virus. It was this prophet said so, and so that, you know, everybody's just banking out. They're looking for an answer, so they're doing things that maybe don't even make sense because they're told what, but they're not necessarily told why, and there isn't really a why to that. That's just, you know, a
right.
False prophet that, and false prophets arise in crises, you know, so that happens. That happens throughout the Bible. That happens in real life. And so people are fighting, you know, what's true and what's a lie. It's difficult to sort of discern those things in a situation like this.
Has the government of Sierra Leone cooperated with your efforts? Are they supporting what you're doing?
The government is really just asking anybody to help with whatever they can. There's been a little bit of a slow response by the government, and that's been one of the things people have complained about a little bit as things have gotten worse. But I think they're grateful for anybody doing anything to help. Now, we're looking at also taking in some supplies to Sierra Leone and sending some relief supplies in. Right now, because of the scare, there's the availability of basic supplies is really limited. You cannot go into a shop and buy bleach. You can't go into a shop and buy gloves. You can't buy hand sanitizer. So all of these sort of common things that are needed to be able to sanitize and disinfect and things like that are not available. And so we want to get some supplies together and send those over. We're working with Samaritan's Purse right now to try to make that happen. And they are partnering with us in that.
And there's other global health professionals, too, obviously, that are addressing the concern here. And, mm-hmm. and are you contacted with them and trying to do, you know, a group effort?
Yeah, it's difficult to collaborate in a situation like this with all the different entities that might be involved. Who we are really collaborating with is the global community health evangelism community. So there's a global network of organizations that utilize the community health evangelism strategy that we use also as our core strategy in Women of Hope. And they, like I said, because of our expertise in dealing with education of low literacy level people,
are tapping us to help produce some things. We had contracted with an artist who has just today got the final copy of a picture booklet that is going to be used and distributed widely throughout Sierra Leone that sort of walks you through what is Ebola, the different responses to Ebola, what is it, what are the symptoms, and how can the community, what are the preventions, and then how can the community come together to try to end the crisis. And so we've also developed a lesson that really is geared at not just the facts about Ebola, but also addressing these fears and the worldview issues that surround that. Because if you don't address both, you're really not addressing the issue at all. The facts are going to be eliminated by the worldview issues and the belief systems of people, and they won't accept facts as facts unless you address both of those. So we are just ready to send those over to, and we've got it translated into French for Guinea and any other country that may need it for prevention. There are, you know, most of the countries in West Africa are French speaking. Right now, the Ebola outbreak, three of the four countries are English speaking and one is French speaking, but it still could continue to spread. And so we've got it in French as well for Guinea and then any other country that needs it. So we'll be disseminating those as widely as we can throughout that whole network of community health development professionals.
Kim, when you talk about the training curriculum, as you mentioned, this artist who is developing the artwork for this to provide, you know, pictures and to make, I'm sure, easier to communicate the message here. What about those people that are illiterate, you know, they can't read? I mean, you need a combination, don't you, yes, of reading and pictures?
Yes. And our picture booklet has captions. So there is some, the basic principles are outlined in captions, but the pictures are pretty self-explanatory. And I have probably spent about 60 hours over the last week and a half working with artists to develop this picture booklet so that it is really going to be contextualized to West Africa and then also to low literacy level populations. So there's been a lot of work that's been done. He's obviously doing the artwork, but the development has really been on our side of the concepts and how to present those concepts in such a way that that it can really speak to the people. And it needs to be in combination with teaching, you know, so there'll be oral teaching there. We've also developed a story that illustrates sort of the worldview issues to get people thinking and then evaluating through the story, because it's easier for somebody to look at someone else and say, oh, I see what she did wrong, rather than to say, I see what I'm doing wrong. So if we can put it in a story form and then ask them to analyze the story, what did this person do right? What did they do wrong? What did they do to increase the spread? What did this person do to decrease the spread? They can then pull principles from that. And that's really a basic West African teaching method that has been used for generations. Storytelling is a very African practice. So using this story, it'll help people to really be able to make those connections for themselves.
Have you had good support in the actual printing of this and found those who could help you make this at maybe at a more affordable price for the ministry?
Yeah, we've had, I mean, the artist and the contractor, the graphic art contractor that we're working with have done a phenomenal job and have really cut a discount for us, but it's a significant process. And
You have some cost here. I mean, aren't part of your regular budget for the ministry.
Right. Ooh. Yes, we have had a significant increased cost. We also have other nonprofits in the area that we work that have tapped us to say, hey, could your staff provide training for our staff? Because we don't do this on a normal basis and our staff is afraid. And so our staff is really gearing up and mobilizing to be able to educate not only the NGO community, the nonprofit community that's working and the humanitarian community that's working in the central part of Sierra Leone that we work in, but also the church. One of the complaints that's come from West Africa is the church isn't doing anything. I think there's a lot of reasons for that, but one of them is like, what do we do, you know? And what is the role of a church in a global crisis like this? Well, historically speaking, we know that the church has always been involved in global health crises. Whether you look at the plague in Europe in the 1600s, whether you look at the yellow fever epidemic right here in Memphis, you know, all you got to do is walk through the Pink Palace to realize that the church was actively involved in epidemic.
If you walk back to the time of Christ, I mean, he set the example with those with leprosy.
Right, exactly. Yeah. So the church has always been involved and the church needs to be involved. The body of Christ is called to respond to the needs of people who are in crisis, to the needs of the sick, widows and orphans, which obviously there are those now in all of the deaths. So the church has mandates that are specific to dealing with global crises and just in loving one another and loving your neighbor. And so, you know, kind of We have two lessons, actually. We have a basic Ebola lesson that will help to educate people on what they can do to empower themselves to prevent this disease for their family. We also have Ebola, the Church's Response, and those are going to be done in tandem for believers to help believers understand not only what is the church's role and what is the role of the body of Christ, but also to get a biblical perspective on the crisis. For example, the global health community, as you know, this is throughout the media, is saying over and over again every day, this is out of control. This is unprecedented. This, you know, there's a lot of almost hysterical, you know, wording in that. As believers, I think we need to realize that we live in a different paradigm. This is not out of control. This is in His control. There is nothing outside of the control of God. Do we understand why this is happening? No. Do we understand, do we know how far it's going to go? No. Are there things we need to do to control that? Yes. But the bottom line, as believers, we understand that the truth that we live in is that God is in control. And so this isn't out of control. This is, it's bad and we need to respond, but it is in God's control and He has a plan and He wants to use His body to respond to this crisis, whether that's the body here in Memphis or whether that's the body of Christ there in Sierra Leone. And all of us need to work together to respond to the crisis.
Ministering to the least of these. Mm-hmm. And that's what you have been doing, you know, through the Ministry of Women of Hope International in Sierra Leone for some time now. And that heartbeat continues on through this project with Ebola, trying to, you know, provide these materials to educate the people there. There are some financial needs.
There
and
are.
I know that you are looking to address these.
Mm-hmm.
And you're also looking for people to come alongside and pray.
Mm-hmm.
This might open up a window for some more volunteers, mm-hmm, for Women of Hope here locally.
Yeah.
But I think what's exciting is to see that there is a connection right here in Memphis that our Bot Radio Network listeners can engage this issue,
yes,
right here and support you.
Yeah, I think, you know, one of the things, Byron, right now, I mean, let's be honest, it looks like the world's falling apart, right? Like, no matter where you turn on the news, it's tragedy after tragedy after tragedy. And it's not an uncommon reaction for us to just throw up our hands and say, like, I can't. Well, first of all, this is not affecting me. And second of all, there's nothing I can do about that. And so we just turn it off. And as believers, we're not allowed to do that. We have been mandated by Christ to care for our brothers and sisters, whether we know them or we don't know them, whether they're far away or near. And so this, I think, is one of the crises that's currently happening in the world that we can actually impact in a significant way without a whole lot of effort, even. We have a financial need to be able to make these resources available to the entire region, because that's really what we're doing right now. We have a need to provide trainings in Sierra Leone, and there's some cost in that. You've got trainers and you've got, you know, locations and things like that. So there are costs that are involved, and this can have a significant impact on stopping this Ebola spread from continuing. And then the supplies that have to go over, there's some cost in that. So there are things that people can really do that will have a significant impact. Sometimes I think people feel like, I feel like I'm just copping out to just write a check. And you're part of the body of Christ that's operating as a unit. And there's no part of the body that is insignificant. So, you know, the foot can't say to the hand, I don't need you.
Yes.
So whether you're heading off to Sierra Leone to do something, you know, dramatic, or whether you're Kent Brantley, who's been, you know, brought back to the States because he got Ebola by helping people, that's one part of the body. The other part of the body is those that enable those other things to take place. And that's where people right here in Memphis can really make an impact.
And how can listeners make a difference? How can they respond? What should they do?
If they want to provide financially so that we can get these things happening, they can go on our website, womenofhopeinternational.org, and make a special Ebola donation right on the website. Right from our homepage, there's an Ebola on the rotator, and you can click on that and go right to the Ebola page. It tells what we're doing specifically, gives some updates on what's happening on the field, and then people can make a donation right on that page. And people can pray. We have specific people, we can give names of people if they don't want to just pray generally, you know, about the Ebola outbreak. They can contact us. We have an actual prayer update that we provide to, and this is like people volunteer to be on this. So it's a specific, it's not our newsletter, it's separate. People can sign up for our prayer update newsletter, and we are sending out periodically prayer updates, specific requests of needs that are happening on the field. So that's another way that people can be involved, and that's significant as well.
Kim Carbo, thank you for standing in the gap in the name of Jesus. Thank you so much for doing the kingdom work not only here in Memphis, but in Sierra Leone, and sharing with Bonnet Radio Network today. And I would encourage our friends to learn more about this outreach, the Project for Ebola. And you can go to the website again. It is Women of Hope.
International. Women of Hope International.
I'll make sure we add that part. Women of Hope International.org.
Yes.
And get all the details and make that financial contribution.
Yes.
Thanks, Kim.
Thank you, Byron. Thank you for standing in the gap, too, because this is important to let people know how they can be involved.
Friends, that's all the time we have on this edition of Mid-South Viewpoint. I do appreciate you stopping by. I'm Byron Tyler. We'll talk to you next time. Bye-bye.